Grow, Sell, and Retire is the podcast for the lazy overachiever. B.D. Dalton, author of True Gravity and Grow, Sell, and Retire, is here to give you his 25 years of secrets, tips, and systems to take your business to the next level. This is your chance to find out what is working in sales, marketing, and running your business. If you stop learning, you stop burning. Now, here's your host, BD, with today's GSR podcast.
Hey everybody, it's BD Dalton here again, Grow, Sell, and Retire podcast. Today I'm bringing you an interview with some amazing person, Allison Edgar, who's up for a bunch of awards. She's been in sales for 25 years. She's known as the entrepreneur's godmother, and she's going to basically walk us through the secrets of successful sales. It makes it so that, you know, there's some ideas here around engaging your clients emotionally. There's going to be some ideas about why people don't like salespeople and how you can get around that. But I really want you to make sure you take some great notes and come on in, sit down, grab a piece of paper, figure out how you can be a lazy overachiever, take some notes, make some sales, and here we go. My interview on Grow, Sell, and Retire podcast with Allison Edgar. Everybody sells all the time, don't they, Allison?
They do. I believe everything we do in our life, even to get somebody to make you a cup of coffee or a cup of tea, is a sale.
And so I, you know, kind of my leading question, and I've you know, Daniel Pink's come up with to sell as human, all this stuff, and you've come into this. It's we're selling every day, all day long. Why is it that people don't like selling? And even worse, why don't people like salespeople?
So I think people lack confidence in sales, and I know that from experience working with teams. And I think it's because a lot of people don't know how to sell correctly. I think sales get a bad reputation from the shiny-shoed, overconfident, slick oil salesman, basically. And I think that's just how you don't sell, but that reflects on, again, people's perception of sales.
And so when you talk about that, and you start, and I know you have some of this in the book, and we'll get into it further, is it that people are, they lack their confidence, or we're not teaching them?
I think it's a combination of both. I think, especially in the small business arena, people kind of make it up as they go along, if that makes sense. And I think if you look at, they've maybe been taught organically and what they think is right. Whereas if you're taught from the start, it's like sports, isn't it? Look at kids in sports. If, you know, you learn from somebody like your dad who was never good at sports, that's going to be your maximum capacity. Whereas actually, if you're trained and coached from an early age, you become good at what you do. So I think, again, people create bad habits, and a lot of the bad habits is what gives it a bad reputation.
Yeah, I'd agree. It's one of those that it's, you get taught poorly, you continue to be poor. So yeah. How did you get your nickname, the entrepreneur's godmother?
So it was really funny. I work with a lot of young entrepreneurs. You know, some of them are from Dragon's Den, Shark Tank, and I've absorbed in this sort of arena of entrepreneurism. And a lot of the stuff I do sort of, it starts off in sales, but it really becomes a supporter, a nurturer. And when the main core of the business is sales coaching solutions, so it will work with teams. So things like some of the airlines, the Discovery Channel, lots of different teams. And there used to be funding from the UK government to support the work that I do. But when they pulled the funding, the ones who really, really needed me most were the startups and the micro businesses. So these are the ones that are at the highest risk of failure and the ones who really don't know how to sell. But they're also the ones who don't have much money. So it's trying to, again, balance my business and help the people who need me most. So I've got one of my clients who is the naughtiest boy you have ever met. He's such good fun, but he's really naughty. And I said to him, look, I'm creating a new brand, a side shoot from Sales Coaching Solutions, but to work with the startups and the micros. And I need a name, Allison Edgar. It's just, you know, anybody could be called that. And he said, that's so easy. You are the entrepreneur's godmother. And I thought, you know, I so am. So obviously I trademarked it and I trade under that brand. But when I was writing the book, I had to look up godmother. You know, what's the dictionary definition? And it's somebody who is pioneering in an organization. And then that's where I thought, actually, the role of the godmother is to support the entrepreneurs. So I used it, I stuck, people love it. And it's quite catchy as well from a marketing perspective.
That's awesome. Yeah, it's kind of that. I came up with the lazy overachiever because we've done okay for ourselves, but it's that I don't want to do it. I want to work hard, but I don't want to work too hard. So, you know, you got to find ways around it and meet great people and create a good ecosystem around it. So when you're going through that and you started talking about it's very difficult to get through that thing and not be taught right, walk us through a difficult sales thing that you just sat back and said, I could have done that better, or how you've run into some trials and tribulations when it comes to selling and how have you overcome it?
Yeah, I mean, I think this is an interesting one because, again, another thing which I see quite a lot in sales and in small business and actually even at senior management level is imposter syndrome. So for me, you know, there's been sales. I think, again, that's part of being good at something is to review what didn't go well and what you can do better. So touch wood, when I was working in sales, so my background was blue chip, you know, there was odd times where you would drop the ball and, you know, maybe not follow process and try and cut corners, which, again, I think for salespeople becomes quite habitual cutting corners. I always try to strip back. But the main thing was when I set the business up and I had to sell myself. That was really tricky because you've always had an umbrella that you didn't have to take it personally. So if they didn't want to buy advertising, I could blame the directory company. Or if they didn't want to buy a phone system, you know, I could kind of blame that phone system wasn't right for them. But when it's you that people are buying, it's really tricky to not take it personally. And when I set up the company, my kids were really small and I would go to a networking event. And again, please don't tell my husband and children this, but it was evening networking. So sometimes it just felt great to get out of the house and get a glass of wine. I wasn't so bothered about getting any business. I just wanted to escape the family for a couple of hours. And it was through a chamber of commerce. And one of the girls said, oh, that man over there wants sales training. And I'm like, oh, he doesn't want me then. He'll want a real sales trainer. So again, I look back at that and think, I should have had the confidence, because if you don't have confidence in your product or service, you can't sell it. And that included at the start of the journey what I was going to deliver. So I quickly overcame the imposter syndrome to obviously go on and the company's doing really well. But I think that was the initial thing, was the moving of selling somebody else's product or service to actually selling me as a brand.
That's awesome. So when you said this,
the imposter syndrome and believing that I can do it.
Cool. So then you said this is a while ago now, that people really need to have a system. So you've come up with the four pillars of sales, or at least that's one of the ethos in the book. So what are the four pillars of sales? Walk us through it.
So it was, again, quite interesting. When I set up the company, I'd never been a sales trainer. So I was teaching them, again, it was probably quite random. And it was one day, I do DISC. So one of the things is around the behaviours. And DISC is red, which is really task-focused, yellow, which is sunshine and radiance, green, which is carey-sherey, and then blue, which is attention to detail. And what I did was I'd always based what I taught on the overachievers, the top performers. Mm-hmm. And actually, when I looked at what I taught, everything fitted in the same type of pillar as DISC. So the first one is people buy people, and they buy people who are like them. So the top performers could always understand and adapt their behavior. So they were selling in the style of the person who was the customer rather than their own style. They were very chameleon. The next thing is sales process. And again, coming from blue chip, you know, you're pretty much sales trained every day or coached every day to really achieve well. And sales is a process. Literally, I will go out and watch people sell, my clients. I'll go out and observe them. And it's a bit like, I call it like Swan Lake. So it doesn't matter whether you see Swan Lake in London at Covent Garden or Sydney Opera House or in New York, the steps are the same. And that's the same for sales. It doesn't matter what you sell. The process is exactly the same. And again, when I watch good salespeople, for me, it's like a magical dance. And I know what they're going to say next because they're following process. So process was really important in the book. The next one is strategy. So on LinkedIn, there's so much talk about, is cold calling dead or is it alive? And actually, to me, it's about strategic selling and using things like LinkedIn and social media. And that's something that I've done in my own business. So again, I just teach what I've done myself. So that strategy is really important. And then the last thing is confidence, because again, if you've not got confidence in yourself, people will not have confidence in you and they will not buy your product and service. So it's just the combination of the other three, the behaviours, the process and the strategy, actually just naturally brings pillar number four into play. So that's what the book was based on. And I don't know, people just love the book and I'm quite shocked by how well received it's been and how much people love it. But it's written from my... not through theory, it's written through actually what I do on a day-to-day basis.
Yeah, that's the thing. And it sounds like, and we've done the research on you, and one of the reasons we have you on the show is because it's you and I run around in a space of coaching or whatever people want to put their quote fingers up around. But it's that you still have your finger on the pulse. You're not just talking about it. You're actually implementing it and doing it and helping clients. That's very, very important to creating lazy overachievers. You know, you have to actually be implementing it and be able to do it yourself. So
I think it's massive because, you know, there is that theory, those who do, those who can't teach. But I think when you run your own business, like I'm selling every single day and I love sales. This is the thing, that's the bit of my business that I never want to lose because I enjoy it so much. And I think my enthusiasm and passion for sales comes through in the book and it comes through again when I teach.
And that's so let's move on to, so we've gone through that. So people buy from like people and people, we don't want to be a chameleon because the best day at work you could ever have is if you could just be you and make all the money that you needed to make. Then you've got processes and you've got a strategy to implement those processes. And that then makes you confident, you know, whether it was the Karate Kid or whatever it is. And you don't know how you got there, but you finally made it to the final round of the championship. So what are three tools that a salesperson would need? I know we've got the pillars, but if you were to say somebody is going to walk away today and they either going to look in your book and you're going to tell them exactly where to go, what are three things that they could implement today that would make them, you know, that would make them say, thank you very much, entrepreneur's godmother. I couldn't have made it without you.
So I would say top tip number one is so many salespeople talk about themselves. And we do this, and we do that, and we do the next thing. People actually don't care. Customers only care what is in it for them. So I talk about being on the Titanic and it's about to sink. Who's the first person you want to save? And they go, me. And I'm like, well, that's what your customers are like. They don't want all the waffle. They want what you're going to do for them. So that is massive top tip. How do you get and achieve getting what they actually need? Not what they want, but what they need. Questioning techniques. And it should be the Bob basic of all sales, but so many people get it wrong. You know, they go, can I send you an email? Would you like to do this? Would you like to do that? It's all about using great open questions and then listening to the answer and then probing in further. You know, as young children, you know, when they learn to speak, they are naturally born to ask why. And yet as we get older, we've been conditioned really by education to move into closed questions, to be polite. I challenge people to think like a 3-year-old. Oh, and what's the main challenge you have in your business? And why is that? And who does that? And how do you deal with that? And why do you deal with that? And again, really thinking like a 3-year-old is a massive, massive top tip. The other thing is, you know, test an intention. Do not be a busy fool. You know, when it comes to this part, how many times do you chase somebody to get a yes or a no answer? You know, when it comes to that, my top tip would be scale things in. So just for my clarity and sanity, on a scale of 1 to 5, if 1 means that actually you think this is never going to happen and 5 means that you're ready to place an order now, where are you in your thought process? So again, it's literally around positioning your questions and scaling in. So that would be my 3 top tips. What's in it for the customer? Really good open questions and test an intention.
That's awesome. And I think that Titanic technique is, you know, that gets people back into that. They're not buying what you're selling. They're buying what you can provide for them, save them time, energy, and focus. So it makes it really good. No, those are awesome things. So let's talk a little bit about you. A couple of fun things here. So goals for 2019, you know, you sound like a very goals driven person. So let's hear what your goals are for 2019.
I love goals. I think it's goals that keep you functioning and make you get up in the morning. Especially when you run your own business, it's easy to get waylaid or believe the hype. So 2019 will see the year of book number 2. So I am 9,000 words in. I've got the structure and I've got the shape. But I've done a TEDx. So that was end of 18. So the TEDx is called The Art of Getting What You Want. And then book 2, because the thing I found really odd is Secrets of Successful Sales is being bought by people from all walks of life, not necessarily business owners or salespeople. And they're taking what I teach and they're using it in their everyday lives. So it's going to be lovely to see case studies and examples of people who have used the book. So 2019 will see the year of that. And it also is odd. Every year we've turned, it's always been a 6-figure business. We've always made profit. I've always taken a salary from day 1 of incorporation. But every year we have the year of the, and we call it, so we had the year of the Jaguar car. We had the year of us all getting maxed. This year, 18, was the year of the designer handbag. And then 2019 is the year of making even more money. That's like we've got more money goals because although I'm not, you know, I've got pretty much a lot of the material things that I want in my life. There's other things, again, taking it on to the next level financially is what we're at for 2019.
Perfect. Okay, so what tech or book or podcast is currently enhancing your life?
So I tell you the one thing, and we talk about it a lot. So based on the quadrant time management system and Stephen Covey's 7 Habits type things.
Yes.
We will teach a lot through time management because a lot of people don't make time for sales and that's why their businesses don't perform at the maximum. So we teach a thing called Alison Edgar's Big Balls. And rather than the tennis balls and ping pong balls. And
yes.
What we do is, again, I think that's why I'm so productive because my time is really segmented and we use Trello. So I'm a massive, massive Trello fan because even as a team, we'll delegate in ball sizes. So for example, in a couple of weeks, we're working with Thomas Cook Airlines.
Yes.
For their OMG Sales Achievers event. And again, one of those things is like we've got all the tasks to get ready in time for that. So it's not until the end of the month, which is really a ping pong ball, but
yes.
We're ahead of the game and we're treating it as a basketball. So again, I'm very task focused and I do think things like Trello is the thing that rocks my world, to be fair, because it keeps me on track.
That's good. So the simple communication tool that everybody uses to say that. And so you've got basketballs, you've got ping pong balls. What else is there?
Tennis balls.
Tennis
so again, something like we've got an exhibition, the Sales Innovation Expo is 28th of March. So we've got the graphics to do. So again, we should have done that probably last month. So it was a ping pong ball. It's now a tennis ball. So we will action that. But again, the day before or the week before, that's when you get the basketball. And a basketball in the face is really sore. So again, if you manage your tasks in ball sizes, it just makes it really easy to communicate. And that's another thing in the book. People love Alison Edgar's Big Balls.
That's great. So going along that line, so now how can people follow you? Well, obviously we'll put it in the show notes, but how are some ways that people can measure their balls and do some things there and make sure that they engage with you too?
So I'm pretty much all over the social, which is why you obviously saw me originally. I'm very active on LinkedIn. So on LinkedIn, I'm Alison Edgar. On Twitter, we are at The Alison Edgar. The same on Instagram, at The Alison Edgar. Or literally, if you just Google me, we've got alisonedgar.com website, which is for speaking and author. Entrepreneursgodmother.com, which is, again, there's lots of blogs and lots of free courses on that site as well. And then for teams, we are salescoachingsolutions.co.uk. But I'm not hard to miss because I'm obviously on brand all the time because I wear pink. So everything's bright pink. So I'm quite hard to miss, to be fair.
That's cool. So now let's see here. So let's change this up a little bit because you've given us three. So I'll give you time to think for a second, but and we'll come back to this. Is what is the best sales question that somebody's ever asked you? So,
I'm quite easy to sell to. I know that sounds quite half, but they say that salespeople are the easiest people to sell to.
Because we feel bad. You know, enough we feel bad. We know what the struggle is. The struggle's real because you're sitting on the other side of the phone or the door or the table from that person typically. So you're willing them through it, aren't you?
Definitely. And I love a challenge. So I love to negotiate. So when it comes to negotiation skills, you know, I'll always throw in what's the best price you can do that for. And never buy anything at cost. I will always, again, it's the thrill of the chase. Even if I'm going, like we spent some time in the States, in Florida, and we sort of covered down to the Keys. And one of my favourite things is I'll look on booking.com or one of the online sites and see what I can get it for there. Then I'll go into the front desk and I'll try and haggle below that rate because I know that they've obviously got a commission on there for the booking agency. And even if I save like a couple of quid or a couple of bucks, I feel like I've won the lottery. I just love it. I love to negotiate. So I can't think of a question. I'm trying to think of...
Actually, let's take it back to that. So I would say since you're talking about things that people should do on a daily basis, I think that would be everybody should, if they're listening to the Grow, Sell, and Retire podcast and they've just listened to this, I think if they wrote down 5 B's for the week and barter once, 5 times in a week for something, whether it's an extra whatever in your latte, you know, free vanilla syrup, whatever else it is. But try to barter 5 times a week. That would be...
Oh, for sure. But, and you look at that from a sales perspective, you know, if you can save money on your costs, then you don't have to sell as much at the top end, or you can make more money and retire earlier. So that's where, especially with independent traders or independent stores, never, ever, ever buy it at full price because you don't have to. They'll always do you a deal.
That's awesome. Thank you so much for coming on today, and it's just been fabulous. So, and you're up for a business book award?
I didn't get shortlisted, which is a bit of a surprise. It's really interesting because it's done so well. I mean, even today, so the book is 1 year old. It was 1 year old on the 6th of the month, and today on Amazon.co.uk. It's the audio book is at number 6 and the paperback is at number 10. So a year down the track, I have created, and this is another one of the goals, I wanted to create a classic sales book. You know, you talked earlier about Daniel Pink and, you know, you look at, I mean, in Amazon.com, it was actually partnered with Daniel Pink and Stephen Covey as a package together. And I'm like, wow, when your book gets packaged with those books, you know you've made it.
Yeah, no, those are awesome. Yeah, and it's funny. I didn't submit either book last year to the award, and it's great because I made so many friends when I went to the Business Book Awards, and a lot of them have come on the show. But it's a fickle thing, you know. And there's so many awards out there right now for all the stuff that we go through business wise because that's a complete business in itself. But I think awards. Don't buy Jaguars and awards don't buy very expensive handbags. So I think that you've come out ahead.
I think that that's an interesting thing, because the lesson on that one is it's getting the balance right of your time. So it comes back to Alison Edgar's Big Balls, because you can spend a lot of time feeding your ego. And again, these things are great. Growing my profile, I definitely, you know, I won the UK's top 10 business advisor, number one sales advisor. So these things really, really, really have helped. But now I'm, again, and I think this is when you know you've kind of made it, is when you don't enter awards anymore, you just judge them. And I just judge the world MBAs. So, you know, you look at how hard it is to get an MBA. They've got little old me from a high-rise flat outside Glasgow judging these things now. And I think coming back to goals, these are the things. If you aim your goals really high and you take the steps to reach there, and no goal is too high, because I would never have thought, you know, going back years ago when I worked for as an employee in sales, you know, would I ever have been able to do that? Well, I kind of always, like, I know what my goals are. And no goal is too big. If you don't have a goal high enough, you're really not striving as far as you can.
That's awesome. And just my little Glasgow story. Michelle and I were doing a tour of Glasgow. Michelle's from, my wife's from Anchorage, Alaska, and she doesn't pick up accents very well. And we were on the open top bus tour going around Glasgow, and we got about 15 minutes into it, and the presenter, or the guy that was running the auditory part of it, Michelle looked over me and goes, "I haven't understood the last 15 minutes of what he said." So I've then had to sit and translate for the next 45 minutes as we drove around Glasgow and saw all the beautiful sights on an actual sunny day in Glasgow.
So, wow, the once a year day.
I was going to say, it must have, you know, the skies opened up and there were birds singing and everything else. It doesn't happen that often. But it's been very, very enjoyable, and I really appreciate your time. And I'll make sure that we get this out next week, and people will be able to listen and follow you. Thank you so much, Alison, for your time and your information for all of our listeners.
You are so welcome. Thank you so much for the invite, BD. Thank you.
Thanks for joining us on Grow, Sell, and Retire. For more information, tools, or to book one of our team members to work with your team, business, or to speak at your event or conference, visit BartDaltonConsulting.com or email contact@BartDaltonConsulting.com. Buy the book True Gravity on Amazon. If you want to work for the rest of your life, that is your business. If you don't, that is ours.